Hello, good morning student. I am Professor A.V. Brahmani. In this video, we will see the second article of unit number 2. Already we started the unit number 1. Decomposition was the first article. In that article, we discuss about why the decomposition is required. See, decomposition means dividing the big problem into small subtasks. The task may be of same size, the task may be of different size, or that may be of intermediate size. Until and unless we are not decomposing the problem into small subtasks, it is difficult to perform the parallelisms. So very important activity in parallelisms or in parallel platform is to decompose the big problem into small subtasks that we discuss. Now, in support of this, we have seen dense matrix multiplication with vector elements. And similarly, our database gives an example that two examples we have seen which tell us the importance of what is meant by decomposition. Now, in today's article, we will see another concept of decomposition, and that is nothing but granularity of task decomposition. So, what is meant by granularity? See, student, the number and the size of task into which a problem is decomposed determines the granularity of decomposition. So means, as I said, that every problem need to decompose into small subtasks. Now, the number and the size of task into which the problem is decomposed determines the granularity of decomposition. Decomposition into large number of small tasks is called fine grained decomposition, and decomposition into small number of large tasks is called coarse grained decomposition. So see, these two things are very important to understand. What do you mean by fine grained decomposition and coarse grained decomposition? I will repeat. Decomposition into large number of small tasks is nothing but fine grained decomposition, and decomposition into small number of large tasks is called coarse grained decomposition. Sorry. For example, the decomposition for matrix vector multiplication as shown in this slide. See here, decomposition into large number of tasks result the fine grained decomposition, and that into small number of large task is nothing but a coarse grain decomposition. Now you can see here the matrix is multiplied with vector, and we got the resultant vector y. Okay, now here a matrix is decomposed into four subtasks. Everybody clear with this? That initially, if you remember, in the first article I have shown you the same example, matrix is multiplied with the vector and we get the resultant vector y, where if you remember, the matrix is decomposed into n number of tasks. And what is the difference here? We decompose the matrix into only four tasks: task 1, task 2, task 3, task 4. Okay, so four number of tasks are there in which the matrix is decomposed. Now you can see the task 1, the entire row of task 1 is selected and is multiplied with entire element of vector b to get the resultant vector element in y. So can you tell me that which type of decomposition it is? Okay, so my question is about granularity of task decomposition, where granularity is nothing but the number of tasks into which the problem is decomposed determines the granularity. Is it clear to you that the number of tasks into which the problem is decomposed determines its granularity? Decomposition into large number of small tasks is nothing but fine grained decomposition. Large number of small tasks. So what you are doing here, you are creating a large number, but the size of the task is small. That is nothing but fine grained decomposition. And opposite to this, you are forming a small number of tasks of large size. That is a coarse grained decomposition. So can you tell me which this matrix is multiplying with the vector, this slide figure, is falls under which category? No doubt about that. It is a coarse grain decomposition. Okay, a coarse grain counterparts to dense matrix vector product example. Each task in this example corresponds to the computation of three element of the resultant vector. Okay, so this is a very important part. You need to remember that what is mean by granularity, okay, and what is mean by fine grain decomposition, and what is a coarse grain decomposition. So now, considering the same topic, let me ask you one thing: that which one is better for the beginners? Now you are a beginners, okay? You are in the first semester of this BE computer. Very soon you are going to implement, or you are going to start your final year project. So tell me that which kind of decomposition is suitable for you, whether fine grain decomposition or coarse grain decomposition? What is your opinion? See, student, fine grain decomposition is suitable for every beginners, because what we are doing in fine grain decomposition, we are decomposing the big problem into large number of small tasks. So we are getting number of tasks, and that is of small size. Why we are doing this? To understand the system clearly, to know the basic and the minute details of the problem, we need to decompose the big problem into large number of small tasks, and that is nothing but fine grain decomposition. So you need to decompose your project into large number of small tasks, that is fine grain decomposition. This is very important. I will again we will discuss at the time of your project demonstration or project finalization, that what kind of fine grain decomposition technique you are deploying or employing for decomposing your project. Now another topic is degree of concurrency. The number of tasks that can be executed in parallel is the degree of concurrency of decomposition. This is very straightforward. The number of tasks that can be executed in parallel is the degree of concurrency of decomposition. Since the number of tasks that can be executed in parallel may change over program execution, the maximum degree of concurrency is the maximum number of such tasks at any point during execution. So what is the maximum degree of concurrency of database query example? That you remember in the previous video, we discussed the database query example. So what is the maximum degree of concurrency? The number of tasks that can be executed in parallel may change over the program execution, and the maximum degree of concurrency is the maximum number of such tasks at any point during execution. Okay, at a particular time, how many tasks are running parallel, that gives the maximum degree of concurrency. Okay, at that point, the average degree of concurrency is the average number of tasks that can be processed in parallel over the execution of the program. So suppose you are a database query example or matrix vector multiplication, there are number of points or number of stages. At particular stage number 4, there are 8 tasks which are running parallel or concurrently. Then during that stage, the maximum degree of concurrency is 8, because 8 tasks are running parallel. Now like this, there are number of stages in your program. Stage number 1, stage number 2, stage number 3. Stage number 1 may have 4, stage number 2 may have 3. Like this, stage number 4 is having 8, and there are 10 stages. So the average degree of concurrency is the average number of tasks that can be processed in parallel over the execution of the program. Assuming that each task in the database example takes identical processing time, what is the average degree of concurrency in each decomposition? So this is the problem, that suppose your database query example, now each task in the database example takes the identical processing time, what is the average degree of concurrency in each decomposition? They can ask you. So the degree of concurrency increases as decomposition become finer in granularity and vice versa. This statement is very important. So if you use the fine grain decomposition, the degree of concurrency increases. If you go for coarse grain decomposition, it is decreases. Okay, so clear, everybody clear with degree of concurrency? You keep in mind that what is meant by degree of concurrency, the number of tasks that can be executed in parallel, that is degree of concurrency. Second term is maximum degree of concurrency is the maximum number of such tasks at any point during execution. And average degree of concurrency is the average number of tasks that can be processed in parallel over the execution of the program. Okay, next. Critical path length. Now, what is the critical path? It is a directed path in a task dependency graph. Represent a sequence of tasks that may be processed one after another. Now, task dependency graph is a directed graph where the node of that graph is nothing but the process or processor. And the edges is the link between one process to other process. So we can call it as a message. Okay. So that is the directed graph, task dependency graph. So after decomposition, you find out the number of tasks, and your job is that draw the task dependency graph, how the tasks are depends on one another. Okay. So a directed path in a task dependency graph represent the sequence of tasks that must be processed one after another. The longest such path determine the shortest time in which the program can be executed in parallel. What do you mean by this? The longest such path determine the shortest time in which the program can be executed in parallel. That means if you go for fine grain decomposition, your graph may be big. Okay. And if your graph is big, then there is a directed path in a task dependency graph which represent the sequence of tasks that must process one after another. You need to find out the longest such path determine the shortest time in which the program can be executed. That is the critical path. The length of the longest path in a task dependency graph is called as critical path length. So at first attempt it is difficult to understand what do you mean by this longest path, and we called it as a critical path. Okay, and why we need to consider the longest path? Because so far we learn in computer network or in any distributed system that we need to find out the shortest path. Okay, and here we are saying that find out the longest path. What do you mean by this? Why this longest path is required? See, now if you go for fine grain decomposition, now every task is executed independently of other. Now the independent task will be executed by the processor. Now tell me that if there are three processor to execute seven tasks, okay, at one side, and at the other side, if there are two processor to execute seven tasks, so which one executed first, or which one will be give the high performance? The three processor which are handling the seven tasks will execute your job fastly as compared to the two processor. Okay, so here a number of processor can improve your performance, and that is a main concept behind this. If you go for longest path, then there will be a number of tasks which will be executed parallelly by independent processor, and that's why the performance of the execution will improve. So that's why we required a length of the longest path in task dependency graph is called as critical path length. And what is this critical path length? Now, if you remember in operating system, we are having a critical region. Can anybody tell me what do you mean by critical region? Critical region where the processes goes into the critical region. So whenever we want to do the write operation or you want to perform an interrupt operation, then that process, that time the processes goes into the critical region. I'm talking about operating system. Okay, so those processes which are in critical region, they are having a first priority. The processor need to wait, other processor need to wait outside the critical region. Once the job of first process in critical region completed, then the waiting process enters into critical region. So under critical region, the processes can perform the specialized activity, that writing activity or interrupt activity. Okay, so that is nothing but a job of critical region in operating system. Now same thing is applicable here. Critical path length means the number of processor which are involved or which are on critical path length that can execute your job efficiently. That is the critical path length. So processors which are executing or involved in executing your activity, they are on critical path length. Other processors or other tasks has to wait outside the critical path length for their execution. So that is the concept behind this critical path length. So you see that after decomposition, you got the different number of tasks, and that task you need to draw a task dependency graph. And once you draw the task dependency graph, you need to find out the critical path length. The longest such path that determines the shortest time in which the program can be executed in parallel. The length of the longest path in task dependency graph is called as critical path length. Clear? Everybody clear with this? Okay. Now see critical path length. Consider the task dependency graph of two database query decomposition. Now in video number one, decomposition preliminaries, we have seen this example. Okay. So for your simplicity, see, I will show you this example once again. Okay, this is your textbook, and this is that example, database query example. Okay, so where database storing the information about use vehicles. Okay, and we need to execute this query. Model equal to civic and year equal to 2001 and color equal to green or color is equal to white. So for execution of this query on this database, we decompose and we find out the four tasks. Okay, these are our four tables. Task means here we find out the four tables. Okay, four subtables. This is a big table, and we divide that or we decompose that table into four subtables, and then we draw the directed graph, that is a task dependency graph. Okay, and we get the final result or final node for our database query. Now you can see here, this is our today's topic, granularity. Okay, now the abstraction of the task graph of figure 3.2 and 3.3, that is respectively whatever this figure, this abstraction means this. This is your first task dependency graph of database query, and this is your alternate, means in another way also you can draw the task dependency graph that is shown here, and that task dependency graph is shown here. Now you can see here there are four tasks. Okay, and again they are union to get the new task, and finally we get the task. So total number of tasks here in figure number A are 7. Same, there are total number of tasks in figure number B are 7. So see here, the okay, see here. Consider the task dependency graph of two database query decomposition. So now this 10, 10, 10, they are the time of execution. It takes the time in units. So what are the critical path length for two task dependency graph? If each task takes 10 time units, what is the shortest parallel execution time for decomposition? How many processors are need in each case to achieve this minimum parallel execution? What is the maximum degree of concurrency? These are the observed question that you need to find out from this task dependency graph. Okay, we will again return to our textbook here. Okay, so see here 10 time units are taken by task 4, and now we need to find out the critical path length. So what is the critical path length? If you see, we go back, the longest such path that determines the shortest time in which the program can be executed. Longest path that determines the shortest time. Now you can see the longest path means we need to consider the long path. We can start from task 4 to task number 7 here. Okay, that determines the shortest amount of time. So 10 plus 9 is 19, and then 19 and this 8. Okay, 19 plus 8. So this is one calculation. And longest path in figure B, you can see task 1, task 5, task 6, task 7. That many tasks will be involved in this calculation. So whatever is the answer, we are not bothered about the actual calculation here. But the longest such path, we need to consider which will involve number of processor. Okay, each task will be independently executed by the separate processor. That's why we need to calculate how many processor need in each case to achieve minimum parallel execution. Okay, so that is the critical path length. Okay, now limits on parallel performance. See, it would appear that the parallel time can be made arbitrarily small by making the decomposition fine in granularity. So there is an inherent bound on how fine granularity of a computation can be. For example, in the case of multiplying the dense matrix with vector, there can be no more than n square concurrent tasks. Concurrent tasks may also have to exchange data with other tasks. This results in communication overhead. The trade-off between the granularity of decomposition and associated overhead often determine the performance bounds. So this slide tells us that up to what level you can decompose the task, because we are saying that go for fine-grained decomposition. Again, there is a limitation that that is given here in matrix vector multiplication. So there can be no more than n square concurrent tasks that will be executed in matrix vector multiplication. Okay, so that is the limit on parallel performance. Now task interaction graph. See here, another, once you draw the task dependency graph, you find out the critical path. Your next activity is task interaction graph. So what is the task interaction graph? The subtasks generally exchange the data with others in decomposition. For example, even in a travel decomposition of the dense matrix vector product, if the vector is not replicated across all tasks, they will have to communicate element of vector. The graph of tasks, that is node, and their interactions or data exchange is the edge, is referred to as task interaction graph. Note that the task interaction graph represents data dependency, okay? Whereas the task dependency graph represents the control dependency. Task dependency graph, that whatever we have seen in the previous slide, that represent the control dependency, whereas the task interaction graph represent the data dependency. Now we will see what is task interaction graph. Task interaction graph means how the tasks are interacted with each other. Now see, consider the problem of multiplying the parse matrix A with vector B. The following observation can be made. So as before, the computation of each element of result vector can be viewed as an independent task. Unlike the dense matrix vector product rule, only non-zero elements of the matrix A participate in computation. If for more memory optimality, we also partition B across tasks, then one can see that task interaction graph of the computation is identical to the graph of matrix A. The graph for which A represents the adjacency structure. Now you can see the dense matrix vector multiplication. The matrix is decomposed into 11 tasks. Okay. And now some of the elements are non-zero elements and some of the elements are zero elements. That means they are not involved in computations. As shown here, the task zero, the there are element in column 0, 1, 4. and 8. They are involved in computation. Rest of the columns are not involved in computation. That is what we are trying to explain. Similarly, there is a task 1. This many elements are involved in computation. Now you can see here for task 0. How many elements are involved? 0 is involved. Then 1 is involved, 4 is involved, and 8 is involved. So we need to show the interaction among these tasks. How to show it? You can see the task interaction graph here. So 0 is involved with 1. So that's why there is the interaction link, data exchange link. 0 is involved with 4. So that's why there is an interaction link. 0 is involved with 8. That's why there is an interaction link. 0 is also involved with 0, that is there. So 0 is not involved with 2. There is no direct link. So that is the task interaction graph. So you can see here, you can go for now task number 4. Task number 4 is involved with task number 4, task number 5, task number 8, task number 9. So this is nothing but the task interaction graph. How the one task is interacted with other tasks. How they are, why they are interacted? They are interacted to exchange the data. Okay, they are communicating with each other because they want to exchange the data for their execution. So that is the task interaction graph. Okay, clear this? Here in this example, it is a very simplified, not so complicated. But you can imagine that if the matrix is 1000 by 1000. How many tasks will be there and how they are interacted with each other? This need to identify. And every time, like your applications like Facebook or WhatsApp or every big application, the interaction is find out at backend side. And then they exchange the data. So that is a complex activity. And that is required, the how the tasks are interacted with each other. And that need to find out with the help of this task interaction graph. I hope that this task dependency graph and task interaction graph is clear to everybody. Okay. Now you see the task interaction graph, granularity and communication. In general, if the granularity of the decomposition is finer, the associated overhead increases. For example, consider the sparse matrix vector product example from previous coil. Assume that each node takes unit time to process and each interaction causes overhead of a time. View node 0 as an independent task involved a useful computation of 1 time unit and overhead of 3 time units. Now, if you consider the node 0, 4, 5 as one task, then the task has useful computation totaling to 3 time units and communication corresponding to 4 time units. Clearly, this is more favorable ratio than the former case. Okay, so every time after drawing this task interaction graph, you need to find out that how you can improve your performance. Okay, so this is the end of this article. This is a very important article as far as the decomposition is concerned. We discuss here in this article the concepts like granularity, fine grain decomposition, coarse grain decomposition, degree of concurrency, critical path length. We find out the critical path length of database query example. And then what is the limit on parallel performance, that how many times you can go for fine grain decomposition. And then task interaction graph, this is a very important concept. So you need to remember all this point throughout the syllabus to understand the high performance computing. Okay, so thank you very much. In the next video, we will see another article of unit number 2. Till then, thank you very much.